Professor Bernard Ukman, who is the Director of Global Economics at the Robert Schuman Center for Advanced Studies at the European University Institute. Then we're also pleased to be joined by the Honorable Minister Lillian Ploumen, who is the Minister of Trade and of Foreign Trade and Development Cooperation in the Netherlands. Also joining us today in this panel to present the findings is Dr. Su Jingko from the Korean Institute for International Economic Policy. And also joining us is Professor Mustafiz Rahman from the Center for Policy Dialogue in Bangladesh. So what will happen is that Dr. Professor Ukman will present the findings of the research, followed by Professor Rahman and also by Dr. Jingko, and the Honorable Minister will respond to the findings. Thank you. And I'd like to invite Dr. Professor Ukman to the stage.
Thank you, and thank all of you for coming. I realize we're competing with lunch, and of course the after-lunch session is not exactly the best, but I think the fact that many of the chairs are not filled suggests that, you know, the topic of this particular session and of the research project we're going to talk about is indeed problematical. People are, in a sense, not too enthusiastic about multilateral cooperation on trade. And one of the objectives, really, of the project that I'm going to be speaking to is really what can we do to restore a focus on multilateral cooperation in the trade arena, especially in light of the fact that we're increasingly seeing countries move into preferential trade agreements, creating small exclusive clubs with each other dealing with trade issues. So the motivation, I've already gone through the motivations of what we're going to be talking about here, and essentially this was a project that sought to bring together think tanks and research institutes in the major emerging economies, but also to bring on board kind of views from the least developed countries, focusing on the question, you know, what is, in their view, at stake in terms of the multilateral trading system? What's missing? What doesn't work? What are the issues at hand, given the stylized facts that we have now spent many years negotiating relatively fruitlessly for a set of new rules with respect to international trade? So the process of the project was very much one revolving around dialogues. So it wasn't a research effort. There wasn't a whole lot of focus on innovative new research, because in a sense what the objective was is to try and get a better understanding of why are we stuck where we are, what are the key issues that really need to be put forward, what can we do, and in a sense get a better understanding of why things were not moving in a constructive way forward in the WTO. So this slide lists the research institutes that were involved. So we had the Vargas Foundation in Brazil, we had ICRIER in India, we had the Center for Policy Dialogue, who was represented here, the Center for International Development and the University for International Business Economics in Beijing, and KIEP, the Korea Institute for Economic Policy, who was represented here by Mr. Sul. And that was actually, they were a very important component of the project because that's where the first meeting took place and that's where everything gelled together. Now, the diagnosis that comes out of these series of roundtables that we held over the course of about a year and a half probably will not come as a surprise given where we are today with respect to the discussions here in Nairobi, but the question that was discussed in all of these roundtables is, why is this negotiating function of the WTO not really delivering? And some of the things that came up in all of these meetings related to, in a sense, that the world economy has shifted. We've seen China grow quite dramatically in terms of its share in world trade. So we have these, there's a geopolitical dimension to this with the rise of a number of economies that in the past played only a relatively small role in global trade and today play a very big role. And that also gives rise to concerns among a relatively large number of countries with respect to competition from China in terms of, are the rules really balanced in terms of allowing us to move forward in areas that we want to move forward? The other kind of element that came up all the time, and again, this will not come as a surprise, was essentially not enough support from business for moving forward, right? So I think this is a common theme, and we heard that in every region, that in a sense, the business community has kind of switched off. You can no longer get them excited or focused on what happens in the WTO context, and that, of course, explains why there has been this shift towards regional integration. The other thing that came through very clearly in the roundtables is that there is absolutely no consensus in terms of what makes for good economic policy, good trade policy, where should we be going? And I think there is, that was very clear, much clearer in some regions than others, but I think that points to, I think, the importance of having this type of deliberation and dialogues, because if we can't agree on what makes for good policy, in terms of if we can't agree on what the ultimate objective is of where we should be going in trade cooperation, obviously it's going to be very difficult to get to yes. So this gets us then into issues of the negotiating agenda, what should be the issues to be discussed. And I think there was a general sense among many of the participants in these roundtables that a relatively large number of issues that matter, not just for business, but also for consumers, were no longer or were not being discussed in the WTO, and therefore that explains why there was relatively little issues. Much of this revolved around the way the negotiations are structured, in particular the single undertaking and the consensus rule in the WTO, and I think there was a general recognition that this was indeed one factor that impedes agreement, but at the same time there was also, I think, a majority view that says, well, maybe we should rethink this particular approach, but certainly no consensus, right? So a number of people, a number of the roundtables said, no, we really need the single undertaking, the consensus rule, because that gives us leverage, that allows us to put things on the table that we really want. The response to these challenges of China rising, of the difficulties of getting to yes, has led to a number of responses. And of course, the main response has been the shift towards preferential trade agreements, mega-regional trade agreements. And that, of course, was something which, not surprisingly, was a matter of great concern for many of the participants in the roundtables, especially fears of exclusion, what is going to happen given that a large number of countries are getting together and essentially defining the rules for themselves, and we're not invited to be a member of that club, independent of whether we like those rules or not. So the whole issue of discrimination, I think, is a big concern, and I think it should be a concern, because there are certainly concerns to be had about trade diversion, about writing down rules which might affect the ability of excluded countries from participating. Negotiation function. Bali was a success in terms of generating from an economic development point of view, in terms of lowering trade costs over time, which is very important. The development of an LDC package, so actually addressing and putting a number of issues on the table that matter for the LDCs, but no progress to date on rulemaking, and we also see that here in Nairobi. So in terms of the recommendations that come out of this series of roundtables that we had, let me just go through them briefly. One is, let's stop pretending that we can conclude the Doha round as it was originally envisaged. Right? So is this notion of extend and pretend that comes out of the financial literature that I think also applies here. We should recognize reality and try and move forward on all the issues that are on the table in the Doha round that are very important. But at the same time, we also need to address new issues which are of great interest and concern to business and which are not being addressed in the WTO today. Another thing that came out very clearly from the roundtables is implement the trade facilitation agreements, but also do what you can to ensure that the trade and services negotiations that are ongoing and that are currently outside the WTO, make sure, try what can be done to bring those back into the WTO so that, again, everybody benefits from what is agreed. Another common element of much of the discussion in these various roundtables was there's not enough discussion on the various issues that actually matter for the countries concerned with trade issues. So that points to much more need for a process of deliberation, to some extent of the kind that we had in these roundtables, but we need more discussion as to what the issues are, a better sense of what the economic interests are at stake here, and again, trying to get to an agreement that at least some areas, we know what good policy is, we know where we want to go before we start negotiating anything. And I think here the trade facilitation agreement was generally seen as a very good model of trying to get, using a process of discussion, deliberation, on identifying where do we need to go. Those are the various provisions that we find in the trade facilitation agreement. But then also put on the table development assistance, help in order to help those countries that need it implement what everybody agrees is good policy, right? So in that sense, I think there was a general sense in all of the roundtable meetings that the TFA could actually be kind of a rule, kind of a groundbreaking initiative in the WTO by actually combining good policy practice, agreement on that, with assistance and allowing countries to decide for themselves how long it's going to take them to implement, as opposed to that being imposed top down. At the same time, there was also a lot of discussion and I think a lot of support for the notion that in some areas we should let countries just move forward in a small group setting, right? So this gets us to the single undertaking idea, and there was, I think, a general sense that it doesn't make much sense to impose and to require that all 163 members of the WTO agree on moving forward in a particular area, as long as the clubs or the groups that do this do it in an open way, in a transparent way, in a way which is not exclusionary, and where the benefits of those types of agreements get extended to the whole WTO membership. Now that we have with the ITA, we have that with the environmental goods discussions, and I think the challenge, and I think the potential to move forward for the WTO, is to do this in areas which revolve around rulemaking, right? And which is different from the ITA approach, which is really about getting rid of tariffs. So that's kind of one of the key recommendations that came out of this process, is let's facilitate a process in the WTO where you can actually focus on issues that matter to groups of countries where, if they agree on moving forward, they do so on a non-discriminatory way, right? So ideally, that's what we would like to see coming out of this meeting in Nairobi. I think that is certainly one of the things that is being discussed here. And so I think we're hoping that that kind of flexibility will be emerge out of this meeting. Finally, on the preferential trade agreement side of things, which of course is one of the things that many of the participants in the various roundtables were very concerned about, our recommendations is you obviously can't roll back the clock. Countries are pursuing regional integration for many reasons, many of which are perfectly legitimate and make a lot of economic sense. But we need to do much more to actually learn from what is happening in those agreements and to bring that back to the WTO. So at the moment, there is very little of that actually happening in the WTO. They only look at agreements when they are signed. There's really not a process of interaction. There's really not a process of learning. And we think that is very important because you can identify potentially areas, policy areas, where there is cooperation in a preferential trade agreement setting that you could multilateralize. But the only way you can actually identify what could be multilateralized is if you actually engage in a process of talking and understanding and studying what those issues are, because otherwise, of course, it won't happen. So let me stop there and pass the floor to Mustafa Zier. Thank you. All the materials are on this website.
Good afternoon, Honorable Minister, my fellow panelists, dear guests. Let me first of all register our deep gratitude for all of your presence here, particularly Honorable Minister. Your presence is very encouraging. As Bernard has mentioned, our Center for Policy Dialogue, Dhaka, Bangladesh, was a partner of this exercise, and we were very happy that we had a partner like SIA, which really wanted to find out ways and means and solutions to the statement that Bernard has talked about in the context of the WTO. But let me bring in the particular focus of the least developed countries and begin by mentioning that for the weaker nations, a rule-based system is always good. A rule-based system with a special and differential treatment. I think that is the general observation that I would like to make as a representative from the list. The second is that it's just not charity, because as I was also mentioning, that we are also large markets for the developed countries. All of our countries have large trade deficits with the developed countries. So if we develop, it is also the market development of the developed countries, market access for the developed countries as well. So there has to be some enlightened self-interest also over here. It's just not charity when you give special and differential treatment to the LDCs. The third is that here it is a ministerial meeting, but we had another meeting in the context of the SDGs in the UN, where all the heads of the states met. And we had met in 2011 in Istanbul, where all heads of states met for the Istanbul Program of Action in support of the LDCs. So I think that those summits carry some weight, and the signals that transmitted from those summits talked about making WTO work for the development of the developing countries, particularly for the LDCs. If you look at the Istanbul Program of Actions, the heads of state said that they will try to make WTO work for the development of the least developed countries, so that by 2020, the number of the least developed countries is halved from 48 to 24. That was a pledge by the heads of the governments. In September, on 25th of September, the heads of governments in the context of the Sustainable Development Goals, which were endorsed and adopted, they mentioned that they will make work, WTO work, for the development of the LDCs. And the target was that the export of LDCs will be increased within the next 5 years from 1% to 2%. Now, if those were not mere words by the heads of the governments, then we would expect from the trade and commerce ministers that they will follow what their heads of states have pledged. I think that is also another perspective that I would like to bring. Now, let me mention about the Bali LDC package, which was endorsed. And I will just touch upon four of the issues that we had discussed in the context of the dialogues that Bernard mentioned. The duty-free, quota-free, and we know that there hasn't been a lot of progress. Most of the developed countries have pledged that they will give duty-free, quota-free, 100%, but it was the United States who said that it is ready to give only for 97% of the tariff lines. Well, that's not something that really satisfied the LDCs. We want full commitment, full implementation of the commitment of 100%. If we look at United States, our exports to the United States and the tariffs that a poor country like Bangladesh has to pay. In fact, the importers in the U.S. has to pay $750 million of customs duties on Bangladesh's export to the United States annually. And that is five times more than the bilateral aid that we receive from the United States. If you take the average tariff rate of Bangladeshi export to the United States, 15%. What is the average tariff rate of Bangladesh's import from the United States? 3.6%. And what we are also saying is that because countries, developed countries, are bringing down their tariff rates, there is severe preference erosion. And mega blocks and the plurilaterals, you know, all preference erosion. So we think that there should be, this duty-free quota should be implemented fully. And sometimes it is said that the African countries have some concerns, and we have showed through our analysis that we can keep out some tariff lines where the African countries which have concerns, which get the AGOA in the United States market, they get preferential treatment under the AGOA, and we can have a win-win solution in the context of the Asia-Pacific LDCs and the African LDCs. There are solutions, and analysis as we have shown through our analysis. So that will be one suggestion. The second is the rules of origin. We are hearing that there are some progress. We want flexible rules of origin, 25% domestic value addition, and one single percent, single conversion. We are hearing that in the discussion that our ministers are having, there has been some progress. So that's good. With regard to the services, the least developed countries after Bali, they have submitted their request list. The developed countries have come up with their offer list. Not very promising, but still there are some countries which have come up with offer list. But what we want is that there has to be the removal of the non-tariff barriers to services of exporter services to the developed countries which have offered their list of items, and that there should be other supporting technical assistance, financial assistance, in order to enable the least developed countries to export the services under the services waiver for the least developed countries. The other point, which was cotton, we are with our African LDC friends, that there has to be desubsidization of cotton in the developed countries so that the African countries have greater market access. So those were some of the way outs. With regard to the mega blocks and plurilaterals, I think Bernard has very rightly mentioned that these are major concerns for us because it is outside of the WTO system, and as Bernard has mentioned, we would like those to be multilateralized within the context of the WTO and with special and differential treatment, with phasing out plans for the least developed countries. And trade facilitation agreement is one of the examples that he has very rightly mentioned. In the trade facilitation agreement, as you know, there are three categories of commitments for the LDCs: immediately, within 3 years, and then commitments against which there has to be technical and financial assistance. So I think that type of phasing and sequencing and flexibilities can be brought into the picture if we want to deal with these mega and plurilaterals, because there will be severe problems if the LDCs cannot participate in those mega and plurilaterals. So that is something that I wanted to bring to your notice. So I would like to conclude by saying that for the LDCs, we are keen that the WTO is made to work. The developed countries have, we think that because they have made the pledges in the context of the SDGs and the Istanbul Program of Action, I think this is the time, now is the time, really to prove that it was just not a bluff that the heads of states gave, but they really meant business. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Moderate, and other good afternoon, the distinguished guests and scholars and experts, of course, the honorable minister. And I am Jingyo So from South Korea, and I am really happy to be with you in this nice room. And I also I would like to say the thank you for Saya for organizing in this nice session. And as you know very well, the multilateral trading system, which is centered on WTO, I believe is dead right now. And although the WTO produced a small successful outcome, which is called as a Bali package, in the December in 2013, but particularly negotiating function of WTO remains effectively stalled. This is why we are here today, the project partner of this paper, I think the most of concern and idea of Kiev has already been adequately reflected on the paper, which you have already on, so you can get the downloaded some website, which Professor Horkman told people. And I want emphasize or add one thing to that. You know, there are many reasons for current stalled DDA negotiation. But at the heart of the problems, I believe there is a competing view on SND, the special and differential treatment issues. In general, you know, developed countries do not want current feature of SND, and which allows many developing countries free from certain duty or commitment, of, particularly on the field of market access. However, developing countries recognize SND as an indispensable factor for their economic development, which is has already highlighted on the Doha mandate. So I think if there is no compromise on that issue between developed and developing countries, we cannot any kind of successful outcome from Doha negotiation, even though the multilateral negotiation is continued post the after Nairobi the minister conference. So I think we rethink how the, you know, the, there is a very lots of different economic the state of development among developing countries. You know, there, for example, China has already accomplished very high speed of economic growth, but the, still the small country in particular African continent still very poor state. So there are, we need to think about some new view on the SND, which is depends on or considers some the development stage. And then that is a kind of start the, for step stoning for compromising the SND issue between the developed and development, developed and developing countries. That is my point. And thank you for your listening. Thank you.
Now we'll give the floor to the Honorable Minister, Honorable Blumen. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Good to be here. Thank you very much for the presentations of, that you gave on the process that you went through. And before I would make some comments on the content of what you presented, I also like to say something about the process. Because what I very much liked in this process is that it was a bottom-up process, that you've been including many experts from different regions of the world. And I think why that is so important, it is also because this is, I think, one of the key success factors of the recently successfully concluded climate negotiations. Instead of the process that led to Copenhagen, which did not have a very good result, that was very top-down, the French and others, the UN, opted for a bottom-up approach in the run-up to the final negotiations on the climate agreement. And I think this bottom-up approach should also be the way that we might want to proceed in terms of what will come after Nairobi in terms of WTO, Doha round, Doha issues. So I would suggest that we do a bit more of thinking and strategizing around how that could work for our issues, so to say. On the content, I'd like to say a few things. First, as a small country, the Netherlands also needs to have a rule-based system. And already Hugo Grotius, centuries ago, was a strong advocate for a rule-based system. And for a relatively small country, with a relatively large and very open economy, I think we stand to benefit from a rule-based system. We also advocate a rule-based system because we think it's more fair. It's more fair to the ones that might not have been invited to the table in the first place, but should be there. And if you have a rule-based system, that should prevent excluding players that should be at the table. We are also a fan of the multilateral system, basically for the same reasons. And what we've been seeing in recent years, where you see, and of course we are also part of that, negotiations on regional free trade agreements, for example, in essence, of course, it's not multilateral. And in essence, it doesn't start the negotiation process with including everyone that could benefit. And of course, we're trying to hook up to everyone who stands to benefit, but that's not central to the negotiation. So multilateralism, we're a big fan. Now, talking a bit more on what's next, I think there's two approaches to it. One is an approach on how should what is next look like. Let me say a more technical approach, which I will say a few words on in a few seconds. But there's also the other important issue, and that is, what is the attitude that we entertain when we talk about what's next? And then I think, and it's been mentioned earlier on this stage, we have to take a hard look at ourselves. Because all of us who have been part of the Doha round started out with huge expectations, and all of us have been disappointed. All of us started out wanting to work together, and all of us have to conclude that in the end it's blocks negotiating with blocks, and sometimes very set in our ways. So I'm not pointing to anyone but myself. We're all part of this process. And all of that leads to what has been called a trust deficit. Developing countries are talking to me and saying, you know, we also understand the need, and we feel the need, we see the need in our real-time economies, that there are new issues that we need to address. But how can you assure me that the issues that have not been addressed in the Doha round are falling off the table? And how can you assure me that the issues that have been addressed in the Doha round and that have led to some result are not falling off the table? So we also should, I think, when we talk about what's next after Nairobi, be very conscious of the need of an effort to build trust amongst ourselves, that yes, there is a real commitment from everyone to make this work. When we started the Doha round, looking back, you could say the world was, well, a bit more simple, if you wish, than it is now. There was this divide, very traditional divide, of the rich northern part of the world and the poorer southern part of the world. Now, that all that has changed, obviously. Looking at growth percentages in Africa, they're much better than the ones in my country. Looking at the role of countries like China, but also South Korea. Let me speak for myself. It's not the case that the EU and the US, or the Netherlands and the US, is always on the same page on all of these issues. Not at all, sometimes. So the dynamics of the negotiations and the world that is around, that drives the negotiations, have changed dramatically, and we haven't seen that in the framework that we use to negotiate. So that's one dimension that I think we should really look into and take a good look, hard look at where we are. Then looking, then saying a few words on the content of the recommendations that came out of this, of these dialogues. Of course, there is a good opportunity if you come to an agreement in a very, let me say, inclusive process on a plurilateral level, that you can kind of plug it in the WTO system. And this, I think, which is something that we could really discuss a bit more further and more in detail, because I think that kind of modular approach, if you wish, could be very useful in our view. Now, the Netherlands is holding the EU presidency starting from January the 1st. I am the Minister of Aid and Trade, which I will strongly advocate during the presidency the need to have aid and trade go hand in hand. Coming back to something that you said earlier on the SDGs. I think the SDGs, they are the global agenda for the coming 15 years. And they are also the framework that will drive the aid and the trade and investment strategies that all of us need to entertain, because those strategies need to contribute to inclusive growth. So if you say, should trade ministers follow their leaders in making sure that those commitments are met, as a minister for aid and trade, I would say yes, obviously. There's no other way that we can do it. And let us also use that very inclusive, very multilaterally oriented approach to guide us in what is called the post-Nairobi period. So look very much forward to discuss with many of you in the coming months, and probably it'll turn out to be years and years to make this work. So thanks to everyone who has been engaged in the dialogues. Very helpful.
Thanks a lot, Honorable Minister. Unfortunately, the Minister is pressed for time, so she'll leave before we open up the floor for...
Yeah? Okay. I can take some questions.
Okay, so can I have some quick questions for the Director to the Honorable Minister, because she's going to leave very soon. Yeah, we can have that gentleman there.
Thank you very much. My name is Ari. I'm from Indonesia. And thank you, Minister. I really appreciate the fact that you rightly pictured that there is this big divide. But now that if you take a look at the recommendation by this paper, it's actually one of the recommendations is bringing new issues. First of all, these new issues is not clearly defined to how far are those new, what are the new issues that we're going to bring to the WTO for further deliberation. And second of all, could you at least answer three points of these new issues that we want to use to deliberate further on what the WTO should move on next. First, are they trade issues? If they are non-trade issues, they shouldn't be on the WTO, like the July 2004 framework on the Singapore issue shouldn't be on part of the Doha framework. And second of all, is WTO really appropriate for these issues? And then third, we know that the paper also mentioned that there is this economic shift, big economic shift in the world since 2003 when the Singapore issues was dropped. But do you actually see that there is a major consensus between countries that they can actually talk about these new issues? Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think your questions are quite timely, and I think one of the tasks that is ahead of us is to have an inclusive process on what these new issues are, because what might be a relevant issue to me is probably also a relevant issue for you, but maybe I would like to hear it from yourself, no? So for me to say these would be the new issues and this is the way to proceed would not be an appropriate position, I would suggest. Of course, I do have some ideas, probably like you have, and I would very much look forward to discuss the relevance of those ideas and other ideas that might be floating around. Looking at, for example, global value chains. Now, you could argue, are global value chains exclusively about trade? No, they're not. They're much more comprehensive. But the WTO could be a very good framework, provide a framework to discuss them, because they are also about tariffs. There are a lot about non-tariffs. There are a lot about how do we how do we relate to one another in those global value chains? And also they're about inclusive growth. So you could say they would be perfect to have it to be framed in a kind of development round 2.0, Doha development round 2.0. And if you talk about global value chains, I think you should also discuss regional value chains and how to make sure that least developed countries can use those value chains not to be the provider of the raw materials only, but you know, to also engage in different phases. Now, the second issue that has been floating around and was also in the presentation is on e-commerce. I'm a bit of an amateur here, and certainly when I'm in Africa, especially when I'm in Kenya, I am aware that many of you do all your payments through your mobile phone using M-Pesa. I don't do that. I think it's scary, okay? So I always think, like, what if I lose my phone? Or what if someone breaks into my password? Or where is this little thing that I have to use to decode whatever? And so we are, and this is of course my personal view, but it goes for a lot of people in my country, we are very slow starters on e-commerce, but we see the importance becoming more visible in let me say, our economies. Now for many economies in Africa, you're not slow starters on this issue at all. So you might want to leapfrog, and there is something where we need to discuss and debate what kind of framework do we need to have a rule-based economy. So these would be some of the issues. And but as, like I said, this is for me the starting point of the discussion, and it's not for me to say what the issue should be. But since I'm on stage, I can do some suggestions, but it's, I think, for all of us to come up with those issues and make sure that we discuss them bottom-up.
Thanks a lot, Honorable Minister. Do we have maybe some other questions for the Minister?
Okay, Madam Minister, I'm coming from the private sector. During the conclusive deliberation that has passed and then that are coming forth, is there a room for the private sector's participation on the core meetings, not on the periphery, on the core business day? Because that's one thing that is shedding the private sector world, you know, in a diversity of ideas. And sometimes, as ministers, you are the policy makers. So the minute you bring the policies downward, the people who are finding hot, you know, in their shoes are the private sector developers. And at the end of the day, the government derives their existence from these private sectors. What would you say about that?
Yeah, great question. Let me say two things about it. One is to, again, have the parallel with the sustainable development goals and the financing for those sustainable development goals that we decided on in Addis Ababa in July. Like in the earlier years, that would also have been a very exclusive intergovernmental meeting. Now, for the first time, not only NGOs were invited, but also the private sector was invited. And their contribution to ending extreme poverty is like formally included in the declaration that was passed after that meeting. So, and also in the SDG summit, private sector was very much engaged, also in the run-up, obviously. And their contribution to getting to the goals is very explicitly not only recommended, but also demanded. So I think that would be a good parallel to say it can be done. One of the suggestions that one might make, triggered by your question, is that if we use bottom-up dialogues to start this conversation, then obviously there should be room for civil society and for the private sector to come and contribute. Last year, the Netherlands functioned as an honest broker on the economic partnership agreements, hosting some roundtables in the African regions where we also invited the private sector because of the reasons that you mentioned, to come in and talk with us and to us on what they would need and what would be useful and not useful to them. So I think it's an excellent suggestion. Everyone has heard it. So now we all have the responsibility to think it through and do something with that recommendation. But I certainly feel that responsibility. Thanks for asking.
So if the minister still has some time, we can take another round of questions.
Can I ask a small question?
Yep.
Thank you, Madam Minister. My name is Martha Mugambi, Chair of the Women in Business, Kenya National Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I like the question of what after Nairobi? We are here with brains from across the world. We are here after deliberations on the sectoral parts, but my worry is in three areas. As we engage as traders, as we engage as SMEs in the developing world, producing for the big markets, supplying global chains, building mega capacities for our SMEs, lack of adequate financing for all of us, distant from our governments, becomes very challenging to access to some or even to our ministries, like we are doing today in the presence of you international professors. What are you going to do after Nairobi so that you make these global agendas, the resolutions, the agreements, the discussions closer to those who are moving the agenda of trade and development? Thank you.
Thank you very much for getting us back to our feet and looking at the practical realities of what this will mean for people who are in business. Obviously, when I talk about the importance of, let me say, rule-based system, that also applies for all economies as we see them in your country as well as in my country. And a good business climate is really benefits from a rule-based system, but it should also translate that system in local rules and regulations and laws and what have you. And I do think if you have a good business climate, that is also good for people, because if there's transparency, if there's a, let me say, a minimum of red tape, that makes it easier for entrepreneurs to do business, and it makes life also easier for citizens to call for their rights. And so I think all of us should translate the learnings and then the discussions, try to translate them in their policies. Now, the issue on financing for SMEs is not very unique, I have to say, to women in business. It's also not very unique to Kenya, and it's also not very unique to Africa. It's also in our country, in my country, where it's a very, it's one of the main issues that entrepreneurs have to struggle with. And I think the issue of financial inclusion, making sure that financial services are accessible and affordable to all, and of course based on a good business plan, is something which is also part, I think, of the global goals, where we should really, where we really need to do some hard work on. Several governments have come up with financing schemes for SMEs. I don't know if Kenya has that. My country has it. We also have one for countries outside of that, not only our own country, but other countries in the world, for example, in Africa. And I think the model that we have, it's called the Dutch Good Growth Fund. You might want to check it out on internet, on the web. Could be very useful to other governments too. So we try to do our best, very much aware that it's an issue that will not be solved on the stage in this hotel today, but that we need to continue to work on it.
Okay, thank you a lot, Honorable Minister. I think now we can pose questions to our distinguished panelists. Yeah, so we can pose questions to our panelists, and it will be interesting also to understand what the views of Africa on this issue is, especially considering that one of the recommendations from our roundtables was that the Doha round should either be suspended or that we should pull the plug on it and focus on other issues. So if there are any maybe comments from the floor on pulling the plug on the door around.
Thank you for another opportunity. I want to talk more about the recommendation of the paper by Saya. First of all, especially on the suspending Doha and then move on to the deliberation of the new issues that for my previous question. First of all, if we suspend Doha, the developed countries already got trade facilitation agreement, but the developing countries don't really get whatever we're trying to get from the Doha development round. If we want to move on to a development round 2.0, the recommendation on the new issues that the paper shows is actually the Singapore issues, including investment and competition. So it's again an agenda for another block of countries. What about the developing countries? I mean, like, I know that the narratives are right now we need investment to foster trade and growth, but what about other agenda that is very close to developing countries' interests, such as agriculture, tariff picks, and, you know, S&D, SSM, and things like that? Can maybe the panelists can talk more about that. Thank you.
Sorman, can you give him the mic?
Thank you. Very stimulating discussion, and thank you for sharing your work with us. I would like Professor Jinkyo Su to elaborate a bit more on his point on the focus on the SDGs, and in particular, given the changing geography, how, if you're going to relook at it, you have the developed countries and now you have the emerging countries and you have the LDC, the developing countries who are not emerging, and you have the LDCs. Should there be some reconfiguration of these groups in trying to reformulate the SDGs in order to really make them more helpful for development, and particularly from the African point of view?
Okay, thank you. Is there any other question? The lady on front, sorry.
Thank you. My question is simple. Are we thinking about the youth? We have so many universities, especially in Africa. When we are turning out from the universities, are we thinking about that in the economic shifts in terms of inclusion? Thank you.
Sorry, your question is directed to...
To the panelists.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think we can answer the questions, then we have another round.
Yes, thank you. Also, I have already the same question, how to solve the debt problems. But, you know, I think China is not the same as other developing countries. We know. And so I think we need to reclassify developing country as for example, three categories, advanced developing countries, and the normal and general developing country, and LDC. You know, the LDC should have any kinds of exemption from any kinds of commitment in the Doha round negotiation, and also developing country could get some of the flexibility in implementation issue, but advanced developing country need to be their own contribution to the Doha round negotiation, which is based on their ability, which is based on also their economic development stage. This is my basic idea. And then maybe the kinds of a solution could be very helpful for reviving the current stalled Doha round negotiation. Thank you.
Thank you. Great questions. With regard to the first question, my own take on the issue is that we have to do our best in order so that we can complete the Doha round. I think that in 2001 we have taken the commitments that it will be a development round, and we are forgetting the middle D in the DDR. So I think that before we start 2.0. We have to first, pass the 1.0. So my take will be that, and then we can think about the other three Singapore issues. You know, one of the Singapore issues, trade facilitation, has already been included in this round. So we can then think about government procurement and competition policy and investment. The second is with regard to the differentiation amongst the developing countries. And you are very right that if we don't take into cognizance the realities, then obviously we'll be falling behind. And obviously many developed countries are telling also that there is a differentiation between and among the developing countries. Some are emerging, you are right. Some are not emerging, as you have mentioned. So if you look at the decision in Hong Kong with regard to the duty-free, quota-free, it was mentioned that developed countries and developing countries in a position to do so. So there is already some diversification which is recognized within the WTO. And you have mentioned about the advanced developing countries. We wanted to put that wording, but many of the developing countries didn't agree that there are some advanced development. So the language was watered down into developing countries in a position to do so. But we are happy that China and South Korea and Brazil and India, they have come up with a duty-free program of their own. The third point, I think, very important with regard to youth. I think that when we talk about market access, when we talk about aid for trade, we are also talking about the youth, because if we have greater market access, we will have more production, more productive capacities, and that will create the jobs that we need. Today in the morning, there was a discussion, and it was mentioned that if there is trade facilitation agreement is implemented in the developing countries, only in the Commonwealth, among the Commonwealth countries, 24 million new jobs will be created if the trade facilitation agreement is implemented. So when we talk about greater market access, more aid for trade, more aid for trade facilitation, we are also talking about the youth, because it will create jobs for them. So although WTO doesn't directly address the issues of youth, but I think in a more indirect way, we are also talking about the jobs that will be needed tomorrow for the youths of today who are completing the universities and other professions. Thank you.
Thanks. On the new issues, right? So the paper really doesn't. There are some suggestions with respect to
Let me step back. So one, this is not a consensus document, really, right? So different people have different views. And you heard that Mustafa Azir doesn't really buy the notion that we should kill off the Doha rounds, right? So in that sense, there are clearly differences even among the group. And I think that is part of the value of having these round tables, having this bottoms-up type of a discussion. And that really was the whole goal, to see where could we agree. So I think what is in the paper is a sense of majority view, but not a consensus view. Now, on what these new issues are, I would just echo what the minister just said. I think it's up to you, right? It's up to you, your governments, your civil society business. Because I think one of the reasons we're stuck with Doha is the agenda we kind of collectively designed in the late 1990s, early 2000s, isn't getting us to yes, right? And there are lots of issues that really matter to Indonesia that are not being discussed right now in the Doha round. Now, what those issues are, I don't know. You do. So I think that's part of what we're really advocating, is that we need to have that type of a process. Now, that, and I certainly wouldn't advocate that we go back to where we were with the Singapore issues, right? There was a reason the Singapore issues didn't move forward. Now, I have my personal views as to what the desirability is of actually dealing with some of those questions. But I think, again, that needs to be part of the process. And you might very well come up with a set of issues that nobody really has thought about or has rejected, but I think that really should be part of this process, including agriculture, right? So agriculture is not going to go away. And I think here, the point I was making earlier that the world has changed, it's really changed in terms of who's actually supporting agriculture, right? So in terms of domestic support, China is now number one in terms of the aggregate value of agricultural support policies. India, of course, has changed in terms of what it is looking to see. So the agricultural agenda, I think, has become much more balanced, if you will, right? It's no longer north-south. And I think that's one of the reasons it's more complicated. But I think, certainly from an African, if I was an African, which I'm not, but I think I would be very much worried. And I think the agricultural agenda has actually become more important, because it's not just now the EU and the US that are supporting their farmers and Japan that is protecting their farmers, but it's also, you have India, you have China. These are very big markets, and they are going to affect world trade, world prices, and therefore they're going to affect, you know, the ability of African farmers to compete. And especially in a context where on net, African agriculture is actually taxed as opposed to supported. So agriculture is the only region in the world where farmers are not supported. Right? So I think it's agriculture absolutely critical, I think, that it gets addressed. The only thing I think we're arguing in the paper and as a result of the discussions we had is that we need to think a bit more creatively about how we do this. Now, one of the roundtables we had, there was a suggestion and some papers, and those of you who are interested can go to the website of SAIA to download the papers, saying maybe we should think about a plurilateral for agriculture. Right now, I have no idea whether that would work, but there was a suggestion made based on analysis that some of the key issues also for developing countries, you might actually be able to address those in the context of a plurilateral agreement, which would apply again to everyone. So I think it's just that kind of out-of-the-box, we need a bit more of out-of-the-box approaches. On special and differential treatment, the question on country groupings, I think this is the kind of issue area where economists and development economists in particular will get very creative in terms of criteria and who should be here and who should be there. There's been a very long discussion for a long time in terms of trying to do that. It goes nowhere because there's always going to be people who disagree. So the only group we've been able to agree on collectively are the LDCs. And I think here the approach that was taken in the trade facilitation agreement is, again, for me, that's the way forward. So you recognize there are capacity constraints, there are different priorities. So you try and design an agreement which everybody agrees in principle makes sense. But it's going to take countries a different amount of time to get there. Some countries are going to need help. And I think that's a much more constructive approach towards special and differential treatment than trying to negotiate the way we have it in the past for exemptions or preferential treatment. I think if we can agree on what makes for good policy, help countries get there, that's the kind of special and differential treatment I think that makes sense.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Do you have any other questions? I was going to say something about the maybe African interests, but I prefer to reserve my views on Africa. But so one of the recommendations was that we, because a lot of rules are being made outside the the WTO now. And I think in Africa now we have the CFTA and the TFTA being negotiated. Maybe what we should do also after the TPP and the TTIP have been concluded and those mega regionals are being taken back to the WTO, maybe as plurilaterals. Maybe we should, as Africans, also take our CFTA and TFTA, what we'll have agreed there, so that they can become part of the multilateral trading system in the future. Any other questions?
My name is Charlene, a young person in business. Apart from talking of youth as creating employment opportunities for them, after WTO, as a young entrepreneur, can I be, is it possible to have, like, because us, we don't have as much capital as the advanced entrepreneurs, how easy will it be for me as a young entrepreneur to venture into the world markets and trade? Can we create such exceptions in the WTO so that we don't just create jobs, but we also boost young entrepreneurs in the business? Thank you.
Any other question? Then this will be the last round of questions.
Thank you. I'm Lydia from Kenya. And I just wanted to find out with regard to the investment regime and the LDCs and how is their response towards adopting it? Because from a session that was being facilitated yesterday, the present regime is very punitive. So how do they negotiate around that, or is there a proposal to come up with a new model that is more flexible? This is bearing in mind that Brazil has managed to become an emerging economy without having to go through the investment treaty path. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. George Mngao Konji. Now, from the point of view, China seems to have been sidelined by WTO. Is that a fact or a myth? Thank you.
Any other question? No, I think we can respond to the questions that have been asked.
Okay, on these questions, I think on the boosting kind of young entrepreneurs, SMEs, the first question, I think, you know, to a large extent, what is being discussed in terms of trade and trade policy is relevant. I'm just going to repeat what Mustafa Azir said earlier in terms of giving opportunities and removing barriers that prevent you from actually operating your business. Right, but I think, as was also said and as was asked in a previous question that was directed towards the minister, there are many other constraints, obviously, that inhibit you from growing, that inhibit you from actually developing your product, that a lot of those revolve around finance, having access to credit. So I think this is where the complementarities between the WTO and kind of the development community, the other organizations that are there to actually help you deal with the types of questions you are raising. For example, the International Trade Center, right? So the International Trade Center is actually an institution that can provide that type of assistance, whether it's technical, whether it's connecting you to finance domestically. So I think this is not something that the WTO or the trading system is there to do, because that the WTO is really there to set the rules of the game, as was argued by the minister. So I think this gets into this issue of what is called policy coherence and cooperation between organizations. And I think we have specialized institutions that actually are designed and are there to actually deal with the types of issues you were asking about. So in that sense, it's there, and we can talk separately after the session on this. On the investment treaty, I didn't really understand what the question was on that. I mean, I personally think this is one of the areas where we should be talking about what the rules of the game should be, because there a lot of governments are competing for investment. Right, so that's one example of why I think this is one of the things that should be discussed. And a lot of that competition between the governments is essentially giving money to business to come and invest in their market. And essentially, that's a straight gift to the business, to those particular businesses. Right. So I think if we could actually have treaties that don't just talk about giving rights to particular firms, but actually also imposing disciplines on governments, then developing country governments, African governments, wouldn't need to be competing with each other to attract investment. More important, that would also imply that U.S. states, for example, couldn't be giving money to foreign investors to keep them in the United States when otherwise those investors might go to Africa. So in that sense, I think there's a lot to be done on the investment treaty side, which we don't have today. So that's one of the reasons why I think it's worth talking about disciplines on investment-related policies. Is China sidelined by the WTO? To some extent, yes. They've joined the WTO, so in that sense, the WTO imposes commitments and rules and disciplines on China. On the other hand, does it constrain China from growing and participating in the world economy? Just look at how well China has performed over the last 15 years since it joined the WTO, and the answer is obviously no, right? So in that sense, I think it's very much a myth.
Yeah, well, I also think that, I don't think that China has been sidelined. I think China is one country which has taken the most benefit out of its accession to the WTO. And if you look at the China's growth figures and trade figures, I think that that it has been able to really reap the benefits of membership. Of course, because China was a late entrant, it had to take a lot of obligations which the other developing countries didn't have to under the special and differential treatment for the developing countries. But I think that China has taken advantage of it. The second is that in the negotiations, as part of the various groups, G33, G77, and others, and as part of the very powerful BRIC component in the WTO, I think China is trying to flex its muscle. One of the reasons for the stalemate is that for the developed countries, it is not as easy as it used to be to bulldoze many of the solutions in the WTO. So now you have the India and China and then Brazil flexing their own muscles as well. So that could also be in a perverse way one of the reasons for the statement. The other point with regard to entrepreneurship and investment, in the WTO, obviously, as I was mentioning, that we are trying to do our best to create the rules and the special and differential those type of provisions to create a conducive environment for the development and economic activities in our countries. But I would like to add another sentence, which is that much of it also depends on our own governments. We are for the WTO ministerial, so everything is concentrating on the WTO. But we also have to remember that it is also the onus is also on our own governments to create the conducive environment for the investors, for the women entrepreneurs, for the financing of the women entrepreneurs. So I think that our own governments, the pressure on our own governments also should be there. We shouldn't forget that many of the malaise in our own countries lies not with the WTO as much as the policies that are pursued and implemented in our own countries. So the investment in infrastructure, the various rules and regulations, the implementations of those rules and regulations, how small entrepreneurs cannot take advantage of those rules, the rent-seeking, bad governance, all these are also there. So we will have to fight on various fronts, just not the WTO front.
Okay. It's a very difficult question about China, and I think, but I'm a frank man, so whenever I attend some bilateral meeting with China or some multilateral meeting with China, including the China's, and I feel China has really superpowers in every point in all kinds of discussion or meeting. So I think it is time that China shows China's some kind of leadership in the multilateral negotiation system. And second, I think the exporting the primary product, for example, agriculture product to the developed market, developed country market, is important for LDC. That is why the duty-free quota-free is very important for the development for the LDC. But I think DFQF is not enough for the economic development for least developed countries, particularly poor countries, because the exporting primary product is just kind of access to the developed countries market. That is just a starting point for incorporating the global value chain. So next step should be some kind of aid for trade. So the really the least developed country really need some capacity building for expanding their export. Also, the LDC need some technical assistance from the developed country. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Jinko. If there are any other pending questions before we... Can we have one pending question before we call it a wrap? The gentleman there with his hand up.
Hello, my name is Ileg Wanjohi. I'm in the ICT sector in Kenya. This question goes to all of you gentlemen. In fact, this business as usual, I think, is totally unsustainable. Because if you look at 50% of this world is living on about a dollar a day. The other 50% lives on less than half a dollar. How are you going to get customers in the next 20, 30 years if things are getting from bad to worse? I think you guys need to answer the corporate social responsibility. What are we going to do in the future? Because this trend cannot continue for long.
Thanks a lot for the question. Maybe I'll try to attempt to answer that question myself. I think that question ties with the question on the youth and the ties with the question on the private sector. So I think most of these issues, like what the minister was saying earlier on, we have to have a bottom-up approach. The WTO will not address how we do our industrial policies and how we incorporate. We have a more inclusive governance systems. So I think most importantly, it should start at the domestic level. Thank you. If maybe one of us wants to say something before we... Okay, thanks a lot for joining us. And can we give a round of applause to our panelists and to ourselves? Thank you.